but perceive not. In other words, some of them have, they don't have eyes to see, nor did they have ears to hear. This is that old parable, the sowing of the seed. Some just don't get it. Verse 10. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be healed. Naturally, what this has reference to, a sin committed in ignorance is no sin. But once you have eyes to see and to know that the false Messiah is coming first, there's no excuse for you to worship him after that. You're almost bordering on the unforgivable sin if you even consider the thoughts of following the false Christ. So, therefore, some people, as it is written in the New Testament in Romans chapter 11, God sent the spirit of slumber upon them, this, that they couldn't see and they couldn't understand. Have you ever taken a person that is extremely intelligent in ways of the world and the street and bring forth the simplicity of what happened in the garden and they snuff at you? They can't see it, as simple as it is. Do you know why you can't share it with them? Because they're blinded. They've been closed off for their protection, in a sense. That's why you must always allow God to grow the seed after you've sown it. Otherwise, it won't grow. So you have to leave that in God's hands. Because if they were to hear and understand, if you forced it upon them, then they're accountable. Verse 11, to continue. Then said I, Lord, how long? Question. And he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without men, and the land be utterly desolate. This word desolate should be translated desolator comes, because that's what it's talking about. Desolation caused by the desolator. Who is the desolator? The son of perdition. And again, I'll refer back again to the New Testament. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, you're told exactly when. The same question, when, Lord? He says, don't worry, it won't. Christ will not return until after the son of perdition, this desolator, stands in Jerusalem claiming to be God, to deceive, if you would, the world. And you know what? Most of the world is going to harlotry, they're going to practice harlotry right after him. Why? Because of the deception. Because they are deceived. Because they have failed in avoiding the six woes forementioned in this chapter, that they become lost and blinded by not being familiar with the true Word of God, which is to say, both Old and New Testament, and the letter that your Father has written to you, advising you, whereby you have the wisdom and the knowledge to know and to understand and to rise above deception. Verse 12. And the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. Real Messiah is going to show up, and they're going to forsake the real Messiah for the bad. Okay, why? Because of the woes. Each of those bad habits, and all six of them together, the main fault being the leaving off of the Word of God. You did understand that, didn't you? That the main fault of all six woes and what God was most angry about is they had left off the law and the Word of Almighty God. And that will lead you to destruction. It will lead you into that he has promised, they'll make light dark and dark light. That prince of darkness is coming. It is written throughout both the Old Testament and the New Testament. If you've studied any of God's word, you know that that false one comes first. That's what he's telling us even in this chapter. But there's a beautiful message in the last verse of this chapter that you don't ever want to forget. Because out of all these problems and all this trouble, when God said, I'll send you after you're touched with the real spirit, after you know and after you understand, whereby I can utilize you, I can use you. But why? Because you're educated in the word of God. You know and understand. You're fit for the chore. You're up to the task. You can perform for Almighty God because you know what God's plan is. You know, if you don't know God's plan, if you do not know what he intends, then you're sure not going to be much help. If you are employed in some business and you do not know what that business is, understand it, or able to perform it, then you're probably not going to keep your job very long. Well, so it is with serving God or being sent. You need to be familiar with the plan of operation. You need to be familiar with what it is God would have you do. Verse 13 to complete the chapter. But yet in it shall be a tenth, and it shall return. In other words, there's God's election in there. And shall be eaten as a teal tree and as an oak, whose substance is in them. An oak tree is always known for its strength, its stability, that can be held on to, that you can count on. When they cast their leaves, listen carefully, so the holy seed, I repeat, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof. What's this holy seed? Well, it's God's holy children. Those that have the word. I think it's important that you know what this word substance is. And then we'll reread that verse. The word substance is mastisbet in the Hebrew tongue. And it means a monumental stone, stationary, meaning you can count on it. It's a stone that stands for something. So let's go back and reread that. When they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the monument stone, the monumental stone that is stationary. In other words, they can't be switched around. And they are solid thereof, meaning with the word of God to fulfill it, to carry out. And he knows it because they're touched with the fire of that altar. Our Father is a consuming fire, and through the Holy Spirit, he touches them to direct, as it is written in the simplicity of Mark 13. You will be delivered up before the synagogues of Satan. You will not premeditate what you will say beforehand, but you will speak that is given you in that hour. What hour? The hour of temptation for most people. Not tempting to you. And even the gainsayer is convinced by what you say at that time. What a time to live in this generation of the fig tree, whereby all these things shall come to pass. All these prophecies shall be fulfilled, as Jesus promised in that same chapter I aforementioned, Mark 13. When you see the generation of the fig tree, which began in the year of our Lord, 1948, when Israel, this city, Jerusalem, in part, become a nation again, that both the good and the bad fig set there. And that started the generation of the fig tree, and Jesus promised all prophecy would be fulfilled in that generation. You're in it. What a time to live. And what a time for God to inform you about His word, His letter, His plan. His plan of bringing about the consummation of the end of this age. And that you're a monumental stone involved, solid, immovable, and stationary. That's fantastic that our Father picks a people, the holy seed, the seed that Jesus, His last words on the cross before He would say it is finished, as it is written in Psalms 22, the last verse, they're counted as a generation. That generation is the generation of the fig tree. Don't miss the next lecture. All right, bless your heart. You listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It is getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. There is no need for you to be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject, the Mark of the Beast. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. We don't even ask for the shipping and handling. It is free as well. All you need to do is call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also request your free CD by mailing your request to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
And there we are back again. Let's have the 800 number, please. 1-800-643-4645. That number is good from Puerto Rico, throughout the U.S., Alaska, Hawaii, hey, all over Canada. The Spirit moves and you got a question, you share it. Won't you do that? Please never ask a question about a particular religion, denomination, or some reverend, okay? We don't judge people. It's not our right to judge people, simply to teach the word and let the chips fall wherever they may. Never, never, never apologize for the Word of God to any soul. Okay? It won't do. So, and stay in that Word. Now, those of you that listen by shortwave, it's always a pleasure hearing from you, and your announcer at the end of the hour will give you a mailing address. So, got a prayer request? You don't need the number. You don't need an address. Why? God knows what you're thinking. Why? You're His child. He created your very soul. Because He wanted someone just like you, but He wanted you to be a servant of His, to love Him, to follow Him. See that you do. Father, around the globe we come, we ask that you lead, guide, direct, Father, touch in Yeshua's precious name. Thank you, Father. Amen. Okay, Em, we'll get into some questions. We got John from California. What is a person's spirit and what is a person's soul? That feels awful thick, but it's just one piece of paper. A person's spirit is their intellect, and a person's soul, I like to translate it as yourself, okay? It doesn't matter which body you're in, you've just got one soul. In the day you were created, in the first earth age even, you were still one soul. In that body, you had that one soul. In this flesh body, you've got that one soul. And in the eternal body, you'll have that soul. It's just you, okay? But the spirit is your intellect. You can use that spirit to teach, to lead, or to mislead. It's up to you as to whether it's a good spirit or a bad spirit. Wanda from Newfoundland and a beautiful outhouse, a lighthouse there. Beautiful. One of my favorite collections is lighthouses. Okay, not many months ago, a UFO was stopped and seen in a little community not far from home here. You know, Wanda, we know from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 1, that there are vehicles. As a matter of fact, the color amber in verse 4, I believe it is, of the first chapter of Ezekiel, states that this vehicle was amber. Well, there's no color in the Hebrew language. It's rather the word is highly polished bronze, is what it appeared to be, the vehicle. Okay, so God came to this earth. He had his altar with him, and it was a board. That's why the vehicle was there. It was had his altar there, the same altar that Ezekiel saw in this vision today. I'm sorry, that Isaiah saw in this vision today. J.D. from California, I would like to know where chapter verse it says that Jesus has a countenance and was ready. Well, of course, the word Adam means ready, okay? If you got a Strong's Concordance, look up the word Adam. It's 120 in your Hebrew dictionary. But and there are many places in the book of Isaiah we're going to be coming to a place that will just give his description. But probably his best description is given by the love of his life. That's the Song of Solomon, the greatest love story ever told. And she describes him in the 5th chapter in the 10th verse. It's according to what kind of Bible you have, whether it will be Canticles or the Song of Solomon, chapter 5 and verse 10 gives you a description of Jesus Christ. David from Florida. I purchased a James Moffett Bible from Shepherd's Chapel back in July of 2006 as a translation help. And while looking on the internet under Moffett Bible, I was alarmed to see a statement on there by a man named, and I'm not going to mention his name, okay, because what I've got to say about him is not too pretty, okay, who wrote Moffett's Bible exposed, and he goes on to state that it is corrupt and is, in fact, is satanic. He's a liar, okay? He absolutely is not a student of the manuscripts. He does not know what he's talking about. James Moffett was a fantastic scholar. This man can't even hold him a candle to see by. Okay, that's idiocy. You know, we've got a lot of crooked, satanic people that try to put down real works of God. So you want to be sharper than that. You know, you don't have to study too long in Dr. Moffett's work to know that he was a great scholar. And probably one of the reasons I like to see people use the Moffett, sometimes when you think things don't seem to contradict, he probably put scripture in line from copyist errors, that is to say, put the chapter went here and should have been there and so forth, especially in the Minor Prophets, is a great work. And this man does satanic work if he talks against the work. You know, Dr. Moffett wanted to use the sacred names. And in the original printing, he apologized to scholars for not using the sacred name. But he was one of the first translations other than the King James that came out. And boy, it was people, you know, is the Bible that Paul used, and you cannot give me any other. Well, 1611, Paul had been gone 1600 years, just about. Okay, so people just really don't know what they're talking about. This man doesn't know what he's talking about if he says anything negative against James Moffett in his translation of the Bible. It's fantastic. Okay. Shirley from North Carolina. My husband anointed our home before he died 2 years ago. Is that anointing still good? Well, it's according to who you've invited in. If you invited someone in that was possessed, then you need to re-anoint it again. You can do it. You take the olive oil, the oil of our people, and ask if in the name of Jesus Christ, that's what anoints it, is the name of Christ, on that door, okay? But if you haven't invited somebody that is possessed, it's fantastic. It's still good, okay? And always was. Vitality and Valia. Hope I'm pronouncing that right. Question, when Satan be here on earth along with his fallen angels, what gender will fallen angels take part in, male, female, or both? They'll be male, and they'll be after female, and male, if male would allow it. Michael from Illinois. when we are delivered up with the Holy Spirit, will the Holy Spirit tell us what to say, or will the Spirit completely take over our bodies? Is it possible to commit the unforgivable sin by accident? Thank you, and God bless you and your staff. Absolutely not possible to commit the unpardonable sin by accident, okay? Our Father is very fair. If you were to accidentally not know any better, He's not going to blame you for it, okay? I just want to say that coming out the gate. Father makes His servants well aware of exactly what's going on, especially before He would tag on them the unforgivable, all right? But you don't have to worry about it. The Holy Spirit will speak through us at that time. And, you know, I'm sure, Michael, that sometime in your life you've had an unction to say a certain thing or answer a certain thing, that maybe you had some help coming up with that answer. That was the Holy Spirit, most likely. I mean, it's not that unusual for Him to touch us, okay? Mary from North Carolina, please can I get some verses in the Bible about the Kenites being on the ark with Noah? Sure, it's real easy. Genesis chapter 6, Noah was told to take two of every flesh aboard the ark. Kenites were flesh. All the races were flesh. Orientals were flesh. And Europeans were, actually, many of the migrations later went to Europe. But anyway, all the races were flesh, and they were taken aboard that ark. There were only 8 Adamic souls, though. That means children of Adam through which Christ would come. David from, incidentally, the fact that they made it through the flood. 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55. David from California. Pastor Murray, when Satan is cast out of heaven, what type of vehicle will he be in? Same vehicle, is, whether they're good or bad, it's according to who's driving it. Okay, or who's flying it, just like a car is today. Linda from Texas, my son goes to a non-denominational church that teaches you only need to know the New Testament. The Old Testament is no longer needed. How can I get him to understand you need to know the Old and the New Testament? Well, be gentle, first of all. At least he's going to church, okay? So you want to be real gentle. But one you might say, Jesus would say, haven't you read? Or it is written? You see, there wasn't a New Testament when Jesus walked the earth. He's talking about the Old Testament. And Jesus was referring us to the Old Testament. And quite frankly, you might tell him there's more written about the millennium age in the book of Ezekiel, the Old Testament, than there is in the New. And how are you going to know what happens in the millennium if you don't read from Ezekiel chapter 40 to the end of the book? There's about 9 chapters on what happens in that 1,000-year the Lord's day. So just be gentle. Be gentle. And and again, he's going to church, okay? So bring him along. Comment from Gary from Wisconsin. Recently, a group of non-denominational Christian pastors took part in an informal discussion locally. One of the things that we agreed upon by observation and discernment was that the false teachings of some denominations are allowed to continue, because if the denominational administrators were to correct themselves at this late date, they would lose their credibility as well as losing a large part of their membership. This is true. And at the same time, you got to remember that many of those pastors, their retirement hinges on that. If they would break from that type teaching that you emphasize there, then they would lose their retirement. And some of them, they've put a whole lifetime into that. That's a sad, sad situation. I won't have any problem knowing what I would do. I would much rather protect my eternal life and retirement than I would some little pittance of a retirement here on earth. But that is included within it. And you are 100% right. You know, I have always found, and I've never been ashamed to say I was wrong about something. I really, really try to do my homework whereby I'm not put in that spot. But I guarantee you, before I would want to teach falsely, I would certainly admit I had been wrong and ask God to forgive me. Because misteaching people is a very, very serious sin in the eyes of Almighty God. You all are right on target. Okay, Lisa from Minnesota. At what point in prophecy does it say the marriage of the Lamb happens? Is it before judgment or after? P.S. I pray you will stay on the air. Well, we're going to stay there as long as it's at least possible. And don't worry, Antichrist will put a lot of people on air that have no intentions of being on air. The marriage supper takes place at Christ's return. Those that have earned the right to participate in that wedding. You will read of it in the 19th chapter of the great book of Revelation. And when Christ takes that bride, it is those, and where does the right come from? From the book of life. Those that have, if someone goes astray with the false Christ, they can't participate in that wedding. Why? Because they're not virgins, spiritually speaking. They have fallen off to Satan himself. That's who the Antichrist is. So they will not participate in that wedding. Now, at the end of the Lord's day, if they participate in the second resurrection, then they might be welcomed home. But that's God's business, right? Mark from Oklahoma. After we die and go to paradise and are separated by the great gulf, good on one side and bad on the other, what separates us? Have we been judged? No, the book of life judges you, okay? It's what's written in the book of life as to which side of that gulf you go on. How did the Kenites that are with us now, how did they survive the flood of Noah's time? Two of every flesh aboard the ark. And you can certainly find, as I told the person earlier, 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55. Terry from Florida, I'm so glad God, what are ghosts? Okay. Well, there's really not ghosts. Okay. They're spirits. I like to teach what the manuscripts teach, okay? And this is why you will always hear me say Holy Spirit, not Holy Ghost, because God ain't no spook, okay? He's for real. But there are spirits, and that's what the manuscripts call them, okay, is spirits. And there are spirits, both good and bad, that are, the Holy Spirit is allowed to traverse the earth, so are the evil spirits. It's allowed because this is a war, a controversy between Satan and Almighty God. God sprinkles all events upon people, allows it, would be a better used word, for you to grow to maturity to know better than to follow a false one. So that you can earn your right to be with him in the eternity because you've overcome. Gilbert from Kentucky. How do you think that God will shorten the hour of temptation to 5 months? Do you think that he will speed the rotation of the earth? Oh, no. He just shortens the time, not the passing of time, but there's, instead of 3.5 years, instead of 7 years, there's going to be 5 months, okay? And he gives us that reason of the shortening in Mark chapter 13, for the elect's sake. Doris from North Carolina, what do you know about the Gilgamesh theory? People are using it to try to prove to my son that the flood stayed in... story in the Bible was taken from earlier texts. Well, look, mythology and Babylonian teachings, they have the same stories, but they took it from us, not the other way around. The Babylonian flood, as it is recorded, it was a copy of the true flood, okay? The story of the true flood. Don't ever, you know, if people get themselves to listening to mythology, and you're robbed then, okay? They try to put good where bad is and bad where good is and turn things upside down. The flood in our King James, or I should say the manuscripts, is the flood of floods, and the Babylonian flood was taken from it. You know, Chinese history speaks of a flood over Mount Ararat. It's written in their history as well. Elizabeth from New York, could you please explain the circumstances around when Noah woke up in a drunken stupor? Was the word prostitute? No. Leviticus 20:11 lets you know what happened when Noah was passed out. Okay. Leviticus 20:11 states that if a man lie with his mother or his father's wife, in case he had a second wife later, he has uncovered the nakedness of his father. Okay. So Noah's nakedness being uncovered was Ham sleeping with his mother and was the father of Canaan, is why Noah run him away. You can read Leviticus 18:8, but most preferably it's a lot clearer in Leviticus 20:11. You will find what uncovering your father's nakedness is. Naturally, Noah was quite upset, to say the least. Ellie from Minnesota. I have a question. When did the tradition of Christmas trees get started, and what is your opinion of them? Well, We've in our Christmas message, which I accomplished the other day, and it will be showing again, God himself says in the final chapter of Hosea, I am a great fir tree. That's where it started. The evergreen, the cedar of Lebanon, has always been symbolic, the tree of our people. Because the leaves don't drop off, okay? It's always green. It has always symbolized, Cedar of Lebanon has always symbolized our people. So now the thing is, we don't worship it. We don't worship a cedar or fir or a pine. We don't worship it at all. It's symbology. And it signifies eternal life, which our Father represents. Again, in the book of Hosea, chapter 14, you find that God started by saying, I am a great fir tree, meaning of our people, okay? Jack from Kansas, if it bothers somebody to have a tree, don't have one. That's simple, okay? But if you want one, then understand truly what it symbolizes. Jack from Kansas, how can one recognize an evil spirit? We are learning from your teaching, and we would really like it if you could come to us on Saturday and Sunday. Well, we're kind of your everyday church. If you have one of the big original dishes in the C format, you can get us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, okay? Because we transmit that much, feeding various stations. But how do you recognize an evil spirit? Usually, an evil spirit will leave you quite cold, spiritually speaking now, and that's how you discern it. The Holy Spirit always lifts you up. So that's how you recognize, and evil spirits are not very pretty. I'm out of time. Hey, you know what? I love you all because you enjoy studying our Father's Word. You're opposite of those that have the six woes because you love the Word of God. you love his word totally and completely. Most of all, God loves you for studying it. Make his day, you know what? He's going to make yours. Now, we're brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, you help us keep coming to you. Once you do that, bless God. He will always bless you. And most important, though, you stay in his word. Every day in his word pulls you away from the six woes. And every day is a good day. You know why? Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast audio tape, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a tape catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at this same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
Ferguson hosts Celebrity Name Game.
Weekdays at noon on Fox Richmond.
Getting good internet service can be a challenge, but now there's Xceed, a satellite internet service you can get just about anywhere. Hi, guys. So tell me, how do you Xceed?
Well, video, social media, Instagram.
Lots of stuff. And our old internet service provider?
It was awful, but Xceed rocks.
Switch to Xceed Internet today. Plans start at just $39.99 per month when you bundle with home, phone, or TV.
Xceed Internet isn't just for out-of-the-way places. Hi, Sal.
Hey, Zoe.
So, how's that Xceed Internet working out for you?
My vintage guitar business would be lost without it.
Really?
Yeah. It's way faster than the DSL I had before.
Awesome. Now you can get Xceed and have super fast speed wherever you live, for whatever you do.
For a limited time, get double the data when you order Xceed Internet. Plans start at just $39.99 per month when you bundle with home, phone, or TV service. Call 855-393-3366 today.
Watch Fox Morning News, your only local news at 7 a.m.
Fox Morning News, weekday mornings at 7 on Fox Richmond.
The following fully sponsored program presents views and opinions which do not necessarily reflect those of WRLH management and staff.
Welcome to Gospel Truth with Andrew Womack, a teaching ministry that focuses on God's unconditional love and grace. Celebrating 20 years of discipling others through Charis Bible College. And now we join Andrew at a meeting already in progress at the new campus in Woodland Park.
When you're out with a group of preachers, you got to fight them for the ticket. Man, everybody wants the blessing. And anyway, I knew that I was going to have a hard time getting this ticket for these four preachers, so I excused myself like I had to go to the restroom, and I got this lady, and I said, I want to pay for this, so she gave me the bill, and it was a truck stop. It was probably only $25 or whatever for the meal, and I just gave her a $50 tip. And so she came running to the table after she looked at it, and she said, you made a mistake. You meant to give me a $5 tip, and you gave me a $50. And I said, no, I just felt like God wanted me to give you that $50 and just let you know that he loves you and that God, whatever you're going through, he loves you. And this woman just began to cry. She was working three jobs. She was a single mom. She was worn out, and she just needed a little bit of encouragement. And she sat down and started talking to us, and there was four preachers there. We led her to the Lord, got her baptized in the Holy Spirit. Man, I spend millions of dollars every month trying to reach people. $50 to get a person born again is cheap. That was a good investment. And you know what? If every one of us just loved God, and then if you're out to eat and if you see somebody who's discouraged, and you know, if they are rough to you and say something, you don't know what they've been through. Maybe God sent you there so that instead of them serving you and laying their life down like you're the only person alive, maybe God sent you across their path to be a blessing to them. And if you just bless them, think of what it would do. You know, Dave Hinton's got a story about traveling through, I think it was Illinois, and the other guy was driving a van, and they got to worshiping the Lord, and he got to speeding, doing 70 or something in a 35, and a cop stopped him. And this cop was mad and angry, and anyway, David was the passenger, and he just felt the prompting of the Lord, and he looked at that officer, and he said, "Officer, has anybody told you that Jesus loves you, or that they love you today?" And man, he looked down and he said, "No." And David says, "Well, I'm not going to tell you." That's what he was thinking. But he just went ahead and he says, "Well, let me be the first to tell you that Jesus loves you." And this cop says, "Do you know what I was doing when you came over that hill?" He says, "I had my gun cocked and in my mouth, and I was about to kill myself." And David got to lead him to the Lord. And when they came back through, after going up to Canada, they stopped and visited this guy. And man, it had turned his life around and changed him. Just because somebody loves God, and probably if David hadn't have told this story, it would have never made the headlines. Large numbers of people would have never heard about it. And yet in the sight of God, you know what? That's a success. Getting stopped for a speeding ticket. And you know what? God worked it together for good. And I believe that God says, "Thanks, David, for just speaking to that guy." God wanted to reach that man. You meet people like this every day, and we're looking for the big things. And I'm not saying that God doesn't want us to dream big. I'm not telling everybody to throw all of your big dreams aside. But I'm saying we are looking so hard for something big that we're missing God in all of the little small things every day. And that's what makes you a success. You know what, Jamie and I believe in God's sight. God was pleased with us back when we were struggling and when things didn't look good and everybody was criticizing us. And I mean, if we would have been arrested for being a minister and put on trial, there wouldn't have been enough evidence to convict us. We had nobody following us. Nobody was listening to anything. And yet, I believe God saw us as a success because of the best of our ability. We were doing what God called us to do. And you know what? That's a success. Look over here in 2 Kings chapter 7. Let me show you another example. 2 Kings chapter 7 is where Elisha prophesied that there was going to be this abundance. And yet, Samaria was surrounded by the Syrians. Guess who was the captain of the Syrian army? Naaman, the guy who had been healed of leprosy by Elisha. And their armies were surrounded, and the drought got so bad that people were selling animal dung for exorbitant prices. And it got so bad that these two women covenanted together to kill and eat their own children. It was a severe situation. And in the midst of this situation, it says in 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 3, "And there were four leprous men at the entering in of the gate, and they said one to another, 'Why sit we here until we die? If we say we will enter into the city, then the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now therefore come, and let us fall unto the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live, and if they kill us, we shall but die.'" Man, I think this is an awesome passage of Scripture. This is impeccable logic. Some people are so fearful of death or failure or whatever that they won't ever consider it. But what are the options?
You know, sometimes death is better than sitting there and just dying slowly. I really believe that. Just like David was talking tonight about, they told him he was going to die. And he said, well, so are you. And he just decided that until he died, he was going to live. Man, that's great logic. These lepers had been cast out. They weren't even enjoying the little bit of food that they had in the city. They were starving to death. And they said, we got to do something. If we go into the city, we're going to die. If we sit here, we're going to die. Let's go out to the Syrians. And if they kill us, we're going to die anyway. And they overcame the fear of death and were motivated to do something. Man, I've used this on a lot of people about Bible college. I've had people that year after year after year, I go to see them. And they say, you know, I know we need to come, but man, I'm worried about what happens if I do this and what if I do this. And I've just told people finally, I said, how long are you going to sit there until you die? You're dying slowly. You don't like the way things are going. It was Einstein that said it's insanity to do the same thing and expect different results. And yet there are people that they don't like the way their life is going. They feel like they're just spinning their wheels, that they aren't accomplishing anything. They won't change, and yet they're afraid to do anything differently. Man, how long are you going to sit there till you die? You know, there was this one girl in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and every time I went to Charlotte to Pastor Darian Karen's church over here, and I went to their church, this girl and her mother came over from Winston-Salem, and they brought a group of anywhere from 10 to 20 people every single time, and they came. And this girl, when I first met her, was in high school, and then she graduated, and she was a lawyer's assistant and had a very profitable job. But every year we had talked to her, and she says, I know I'm supposed to be there. I know I'm supposed to be there. And finally, one time, I just pulled this verse on her, and I said, Nicola, how long are you going to sit here till you die? Why don't you do something? And you know what? That girl she quit her job, making lots of money. And her mother was dependent upon her. Her mother didn't have a job. And Nicola had to pay not only her expenses, but for her mother. And it's a long story, but it was a godly relationship. And her mother was a godly woman and stuff, but Nicola just had this responsibility, and she just came out here on faith. And did you know what? She was so successful. I forget the exact way it happened, whether that company in Winston-Salem kept her and let her work long distance, or they connected her with somebody out here. But anyway, she got another job doing the exact same thing, was prosperous, gave her such an increase in money that she is able to pay all of her expenses and her mom's expenses. And did you know it's now been, I forget the exact numbers of years. Mike and Carrie, if they were in here, might be able to tell us. But I think she's been in Russia and over there ministering to people for 10 years or so. It just changed her life, and it turned out to be the thing that thrust her into ministry. She's making the difference in people's lives. She's helping these babushkas over there, and I mean helping them, and these orphans, she's ministering to them. And she's doing things for people, and her life is counting. And I guarantee you it's important. And it's because finally she just said, how long am I going to sit here until I die? I'm going to do something. And if I fail, well, praise God, I'd rather fail forward than sit here and be a failure. Man, this is great logic. And so they finally said, well, let's go out to the Syrians. The worst they can do is kill us. Why are we so afraid of dying? I know some of you right now are just absolutely shocked. But we sing about when we all get to heaven, what a day that's going to be. And then the doctor tells you, you're going and you cry. Something's wrong with this. It's like David said tonight, death's just a door into another place. It's not that big of a deal. We're all going to die. And man, and it's better. It's better than living forever like this. God's got something better planned. Why are we so afraid of failure? Why are we so afraid to do something? The biggest failure of all is doing nothing, because you're afraid of failure. That is the ultimate failure. Man, you need to do something. Life is not a dress rehearsal. This is the real deal. You're burning daylight. If you don't make the decision this week with all of the things that have been said and being preached to you, you are missing a huge opportunity. And if you come back next year in the same situation, you've wasted a year. Man, you need to make a commitment to God with all of your heart and just start doing what God gives you to do. Start with what you have right now and ask God to show you if there's more. And God will direct you and He'll make your life count. You know, recently my brother-in-law died, Jamie's sister's brother-in-law. And he was, what, 60? What? 69. And they were in a mall. Had just been to a show and he just fell over dead. Man, he'd been healthy. And anyway, I did the funeral for him just a few weeks ago. And I got up and started by saying, you know, I've heard the saying often that you need to live so that the preacher doesn't have to lie at your funeral. And I said, I don't have to lie about David Dyer. This man, there is not a person who knew him that didn't know he was a Christian. And he witnessed to everything that moved. Saw his grandparents born again. He was in the public school system working with special ed. All of the teachers came. Some of the special ed students came. He had made a difference. He touched people's lives. And you know what? Most of you don't know David Dyer, but that man, he didn't do anything that was earth-shattering. But I guarantee you there's going to be people in eternity because of his life. What if every one of us just were faithful and were more in love with God than we were in love with ourselves and worried about what people were going to think about us? And what if we just went out and tried to make people's lives better and just lived for God every single day? You know what? That's success. And if God chooses to put you in a position where you influence large numbers of people, well, then do it. But that's not what you have to do to be a success. You can be a success being anything. We need people doing all of these things. So these lepers, here were guys that were outcast. But you know what? Because they finally decided that we're going to do something. They went out to the Syrians, and the Lord, in answer to Elisha's prophecy, had caused the Syrians to hear this sound like an army coming against them. And they thought that the Israelites had hired the Egyptians, and they fled. They didn't even take anything with them. They still had food that was cooking. They left all of their gold, their raiment, their animals tied. They just were running in panic. And the entire Syrian army had left. And when the lepers got out there to them, nobody was there. And so they went in and they started eating all of this food that was in abundance. They went from famine, from starving to death, to being gorged and having every need supplied. They took raiment. They took silver and gold. They went and hid it in the earth and dug holes. They went from being outcast and poverty stricken to being filthy, stinking rich in just a matter of minutes. And then they got convicted and said, you know what? We need to go tell the people in Samaria, this is a day of glad tidings, and we aren't going to be blessed of God if we hold it. And so they went to the people who had rejected them, who had kicked them out of the city and were willing to let them starve to death. And they went and told them the good news. And they went from being zeros to heroes in just a matter of minutes and brought deliverance to the entire city. Because somebody just got up and said, how long are we going to sit here till we die? They decided to do something. I'm telling you, you need to do something. Don't be so afraid of failure. Don't be so afraid of making a mistake. You will make mistakes. You know, when we moved into our previous building, it was actually a bigger step of faith than moving into here, because at that time, the percentage of increase that it took to get that $3.2 million for that other building was bigger than the $32 million. And it was a huge step, and we moved in, but we were 4 months late. We wanted to move in August in time for school to start, and we didn't move in until November. And at the dedication service of that, I had one of the Bible college students come up and said, isn't it kind of sad? Are you discouraged that you missed the timing by 4 months? And I looked at them like, what's wrong with you? I said, man, this is the greatest miracle I've ever seen. I said, I got in here. So what if I'm 4 months late? I said, I've never done anything perfectly in my life. I'm just thrilled that it worked. But see, there's some people that think, oh, you got to do everything perfectly. And if you run into any hiccups, if you pray for healing, and if you aren't instantly healed, then they look at what hasn't happened instead of the fact that 50% of your pain is gone. And the way I look at that is, man, I'm on the winning side. I'm moving the devil in the right direction. And they're just so afraid that you're going to do something wrong until you do nothing and you become the greatest failure of all. I'm telling you, you need to step out. I know it's time for me to quit, but David took all my time. So let me use one last passage over here in Matthew chapter 11. In Matthew chapter 11, this is Jesus speaking. And he said in verse 11, he says, "Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women," which includes everybody but Jesus. I guess Jesus was born of women, so it includes everybody. "Among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist, notwithstanding he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." This is saying that John the Baptist was greater than Moses, greater than Elijah, greater than Elisha, greater than David, greater than anybody. You talk about a success. John the Baptist was the greatest success over any of these people. And yet look at the last of that verse. "Nevertheless, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." What we have in the new covenant is so superior that if you feel you are the weakest, puniest, sorry example of a saint in this auditorium, you're greater than John the Baptist, therefore greater than Moses, therefore greater than Elijah. Because you have received this new birth. You have the nature of God on the inside of you. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, that's success. Success is knowing God. "Let him that glories, glory in this, that he understands and knows me." You know, I'm saying the same thing over in different ways. But I'm trying to get across that success isn't all of these exterior things. It's all centered around Jesus. It's all knowing Jesus. It's all personal relationship. And if you ever tap into this and really begin to experience the love and the pleasure of God, I guarantee you nothing else in this world will compare, and no other rejection from anybody else will bother you. You know, I haven't arrived. I'm not perfect, but I can tell you, I know that God loves me. I have a good relationship with God. God has revealed himself to me, and I am so thrilled with God's acceptance that this is what allows me to take the criticism and the things that people give me. I've got thousands of blogs written about me. I've got one video on YouTube that I'm the most dangerous man in America because I believe that God is a good God instead of all of these things. And I've got terrible things said about me. And you know what? I just don't care because I know that God Almighty loves me. Amen. I have people come up to me and criticize me. I had a guy walk up one time and just start reaming me out and telling me all of the things that I said that were wrong. And you know what? I probably said some things that are wrong. If you came here looking for something wrong, I've got something for you. Amen. I don't do things perfectly. I don't have any delusions about that. I don't ever make any mistake. But anyway, this guy was just blasting me and letting me have it. And I just stopped him right in the middle of it. And I said, "Who died and made you God?" And he just stopped and looked at me like, "What are you saying?" I said, "Who are you? I don't know you. I don't care about your opinion. Why do I care what you think about me?" And he just looked at me, "Well, you should care." And he started telling me how important he is. And I said, "You know what? Compared to God, you're a zero with the rim knocked off." And I said, "If God Almighty loves me enough that he counted me faithful and he put me in the ministry, what do I care about your opinion? I don't give a rip what you think." Amen. And I'm telling you, once you come into this relationship where you know God and you feel his pleasure and you're doing what he told you to do, it just makes you so that you're like Teflon. Nothing sticks. People can criticize you and you don't go out of your way to offend people, but you know what? You're just doing what you know to do. And God is saying, "Atta boy, atta girl." He's saying, "You're doing good." It's like a kid when they fall off the bike. A good parent doesn't sit there and say, "You idiot, if you would have done it the way I said," and he doesn't criticize you. A good parent will say, "You know what, you went 5 feet, try it again, you can do better." God's not going to sit here and criticize you. God loves you. And if you ever enter into that relationship and quit being so goal-oriented and thing-oriented and evaluating success in these carnal things, and if you evaluate success in God's acceptance and pleasure, it'll just inoculate you against so much of what the devil tries to do. The fear of man brings a snare. And if you aren't afraid of men, if you aren't afraid of their opinion, and you don't have to live up to somebody's standard to become a success, and you're just doing what God tells you, then even if you are being sold into slavery, you can have a great relationship knowing that, God, I'm right where you want me to be. I love you, and things are going to work out. Regardless of what's going on, you can serve God. And I tell you, this is what God intended us to be. I believe that this is God's way to succeed. And very few people are taking this path. And because of it, that's the reason they may accumulate all of these natural things, but they're dying on the inside. There are people right here that you may be a success in the eyes of the world, but boy, you're empty. And I'm telling you, it all comes back to the Lord. You've got a God-shaped space on the inside of you, that you were created in His image. And you aren't going to be happy and content, and you won't be a success until you fill that space with God. And when you are occupied with God and thinking about how much He loves you, I guarantee you, it just, what else matters? The Apostle Paul said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. So they'd put him in prison and said, we're going to kill you, and he'd just kiss them. Ooh, awesome. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And he said, well, then we're going to let you go. And he says, awesome, I'm going to go tell them about Christ. But we're going to beat you. And he'd just break out into song in the middle of the night with his feet and hands in the stock. And they'd go to worshiping God. God get to tapping his foot, and an earthquake comes and just sets them all free. And the jailer and all of the prisoners get saved. And, you know, how do you intimidate a guy that if you kill him, wonderful. If you let him live, awesome. For him to live is Christ, to die is gain. You can't get to a guy like that. And I'm telling you, when you find your life, your success, everything that you are seeking in life is all centered in God and not other things, it just makes you different. It makes you that the things of this world don't bother you the way that they did. No big deal. Amen? I encourage you to adopt that attitude. It would change your life. God loves you more than you realize. And if you really understood the mercies of God, you would be a living sacrifice. You would submit to Him knowing that His plans for you are better than your plans for yourself. You're better off serving God every single time. His wisdom is higher than your wisdom. I encourage you to just submit to it. And if you'll do that, it'll transform your life.
Andrew's complete teaching titled, God Wants You to Succeed, was recorded live at a recent Summer Family Bible Conference. It's available on either CD or DVD, or if you prefer, you can get the DVD version as seen on TV. Each is available for a gift of any amount. Remember to specify CD, DVD, or DVD as seen on TV when you contact us. This entire series is also available for audio download absolutely free from our website. Go to awmi.net and click on today's TV offer to see all the ways you can get this teaching. The third audio teaching in today's series is titled, Your Success is in Your Relationship with God. It's available for a gift of any amount when you write or call. We encourage everyone to give, but if you're simply unable to afford it, Andrew and his partners will provide this third CD free of charge. This is the last day we'll be offering this teaching, so be sure to respond today. We'd also like to remind you that we're offering Andrew's latest book titled Lessons from David for a gift of any amount. Contact us today to get your copy. You can use your credit card to order resources through our website at awmi.net. While you're there, you can discover more product details and download additional free resources. Or you can order through our helpline Monday through Friday from 4:30 a.m. to 9:30 p.m. Mountain Time. Our helpline number is 719-635-1111. If the lines are busy, remember you can order ministry materials 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at awmi.net. To write us, use the address on your screen. We appreciate your generosity and hope to hear from you today. We'd like to point out Andrew's upcoming speaking schedule. Mark your calendars to come meet Andrew at one of these events. In the month of October, he'll be in Walsall, England, and in Kampala, Uganda. In November, he'll be in Mesa, Arizona, and in San Antonio, Dallas, and Fort Worth, Texas. And in January, he'll be in Phoenix and Mesa, Arizona, and at the Sanctuary in Woodland Park, Colorado, for the annual Caris Bible College Men's Advance. For more details on Andrew's next meeting in your area, visit our website at awmi.net.
I'd like to ask you to seriously pray about becoming a partner with us and helping us accomplish what God has laid on my heart. Many of you know that we are building this Caris Bible College campus, and it's a mega million-dollar campus that is going to accommodate thousands of people being discipled. But we're also expanding our television outreach. We've added major networks, and we pay millions of dollars per month in just television and radio airtime. So I'm believing God for 10,000 new partners to get this done. That's really not that big of a deal when there are millions of people watching this program right now. So I ask you to pray about it, and if the Lord leads you, join us and become one of these 10,000 new partners.
Call, write, or go to awmi.net today to become one of Andrew's 10,000 new partners and invest in discipling people worldwide through television and Caris Bible College.
Want to find out what's going on behind the scenes at Andrew Womack Ministries and Caris Bible College? Check out the inside story. Simply log on to awmi.net. Look to the upper right-hand corner of the homepage and click on the inside story.
Is it them? Are they back?
Handcuffed my brother, and you left him there!
Oh, hey! The Walking Dead, tonight at 8.
Getting good internet service can be a challenge, but now there's Exceed, the satellite internet service you can get just about anywhere. Hi, guys. So tell me, how do you Exceed?
Well, video, social media, Instagram.
Lots of stuff. And our old internet service provider?
It was awful, but Exceed rocks.
Switch to Exceed Internet today. Plans start at just $39.99 per month when you bundle with home, phone, or TV.
Exceed Internet isn't just for out-of-the-way places. Hi, Sal.
Hey, Zoe.
So, how's that Exceed Internet working out for you?
My vintage guitar business would be lost without it.
Really?
Yeah, it's way faster than the deal I had before.
Now you can get Exceed and have super fast speed wherever you live, for whatever you do.
Limited time. Get double the data when you order Exceed Internet. Plans start at just $39.99 per month when you bundle with home, phone, or TV service. Call 855-393-3366 today.
Watch Fox Morning News, your only local news at 7 a.m.
Fox Morning News, weekday mornings at 7 on Fox Richmond.
The following fully sponsored program presents views and opinions which do not necessarily reflect those of WRLH management and staff.
That means it points to the end times that are supposed to be coming. I actually got up at 2 a.m. that morning and took a picture of the blood moon myself because I wanted to see it for my own eyes.
Welcome to the Believe Factory. Join Gloria Copeland and Billy Brim today as they further study the blood moon eclipses. More than a point of interest, the blood moons clearly mark events surrounding Israel. Now, here's Gloria.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Believer's Voice of Victory. Billy Brim is here expounding on some very interesting subjects you do not want to miss it. Hallelujah.
We're calling it watching.
Watching.
And I just wonder if those folks who have tuned in today watched the eclipse this morning. If you were able to see it where you are. Because this very morning, when you got, in the nighttime we would call it, but before this morning, you should have seen the second blood moon of the four blood moons that make up the tetrad.
Wow.
And we've been talking about this and what Pastor Mark built, how he discovered it. And then the rest of us, like Brother Heggie and a whole bunch of us, we just looked into it after that. But, and we've been talking mainly about the lunar eclipse. But when Mark would check the scriptures about the sun, about the moon turning into blood, several of them, it would also mention the sun being turned into darkness. And so he, I'm going to read you from his book here.
And since we're doing these ahead of time, we don't know for sure what happened, do we?
No, we don't. While contemplating these lunar eclipses, but it doesn't have to happen right on the date of the eclipses.
Oh, okay.
It never has before. Those tetrads, like in 1492 and 93 and 94, they marked a time period when big things were happening.
I see.
Also in 48 and 49.